that you're still looking for, but you are going to have to make a decision where the line should be.
Yeah, sure.
So, but what we had requested was, and what I anticipated, was that Nicole would give us her analysis of the site in terms of both the soil sampling and the flora and fauna. Right?
So you're looking for maybe a letter with her conclusions based on the data that she observed and her soil samples and what we observed in the sidewalk.
Right.
So I think that for the next meeting, you know, to get this finished, you need a letter from her with her conclusions. The board, the commission will still have to make the decision. But,
correct. Yeah. And, but we were all present. I mean, if she just says, oh, yeah, it's upland. That's really not going to help us because she has to, you know, acknowledge the scum cabbage and the jack in the pulpit. And what's the significance of that?
Yeah.
I don't have a magic formula. None of us do.
So,
but we need some guidance from somebody as to at what point it becomes a resource area to be designated and delineated.
So if she can get that analysis done in a letter to you before the next hearing, then each of you will have some information that you'll bring to the hearing. You can have your discussion, and meanwhile, you're going to continue to work on building plans. But you do need to know where the line is, I think, prior even to going in for your application with the NOI, because that's a more detailed question of what work you want to do and what parts of the site.
Right.
And you want to keep out of the 25-foot area, so you need to know where the line is.
Yeah, we do get, just for your benefit, we do get a little bit sensitive to the 25-foot non-disturbance zone. But we're pretty user-friendly. Bob will disagree with that, but I think we're user-friendly.
No, I don't say that at all. No.
We try to work with people within the 100-foot jurisdiction. It's not like there's some flat prohibition. You can't build a house there. I mean, people do it all the time. But it depends on, you know, the kind of, you know, or the sensitivity of the resource area that we're trying to protect. But we'll work with you. And that's why, and I asked your architect when we were on the site walk, does it matter? Because sometimes if you had, like, you know, 200 yards of land, it doesn't matter. You just move the house 50 feet, it doesn't mean anything. So we try to avoid controversy if we can.
Thank you.
All right. So with the, unless there are other questions, with the assent of the applicant, we'll continue this until, when's our next meeting?
The 14th.
14th of July?
One clarification. In terms of that analysis that you're talking about, you're not talking about the entire site. You're talking
about
the orange zone. You're only
talking... What do you call it, the orange zone?
Orange zone. It's the zone within...
Yes, correct.
You are correct. By,
yeah.
So we're not... the Well, it's...
It's around the...
Around the burning.
It's around the burning, yeah. Right.
So it's really... We're only looking for an analysis of the portion of the land outlined by the orange zone that you've indicated on here. Really, that in itself.
Yeah. I don't mean to be argumentative, but as I said, stated before, you do have two lines that were done by professionals. So, I mean, upland of those lines, there was some wetlands plants, and that were noted in your notes, and there were some upland plants as well. And we will have Nicole back and delineate in that orange zone, but in my mind, you know, the most conservative of those two lines delineated by professionals shown on this plan really should be the line. But we will have Nicole go back and do as you request.
Thank you. That's good. I appreciate that. All right. Then we'll see you on the 14th of July.
Absolutely.
Great. Good. Thank you all. Okay, next on the agenda is notice of intent 693 to 711 Randolph Avenue. Thanks, didn't mean to hold you up there. All right. Thank you very much. I don't know how lengthy this is going to be, but if we've got a partial certificate of compliance at Lot 3 Gun Hill next. Is anybody here on that? That's probably going to be a site walk anyway, so I don't want somebody waiting around. Are you on that? Anybody else?
All right. You're here either way, so.
All right, because that, you know, if there was somebody else here, if the client was in. Okay.
It's just you.
Yeah, right.
All right. All right, so.
In that case.
Saturday's no good.
All right. That's welcome. Please introduce yourselves and then give us the status.
Good evening. My name's Jim Burke. I'm an engineer with DeSalle Burke and Associates, representing tonight the HDMW Randolph Avenue Trust, who's represented here by Mr. Paul Holland, Marilyn Newman to my left with Mintz Levin, and Scott Morrison, the Ecotech, with our wetland scientist. I thought, you know, tonight we just kind of do a recap. We submitted a large volume of information, I think June 1st, and it's kind of a lot to get through, specifically related to mostly zoning comments. I did revise the profile as requested. I don't know if you noticed that, but it's part of your package as well. But
what happened at the ZBA? Is there a resolution? Is that still ongoing? Or
They closed the hearing last Wednesday night. And actually, why don't I submit this to Kathy for, well, I can. This is a letter that was a final response to zoning issues. And just to keep everybody, you know.
Thank you. Thanks.
One for me. But that's our final response letter to the zoning board before they close the hearing for information. Now it's in deliberations for a decision. So that being said, I think, you know, some of the things that we've addressed include mostly everyone had an issue with the crossing, and we looked at that a lot. We came up with a design that that works for within, especially within wetlands constraints. You guys asked us to investigate a bridge structure. We did that. It was kind of economically feasible, not feasible for us to do that. We took a look. We did some soil borings. We submitted that information earlier as well. Prevented stone strong details. That's part of your package from previous, and I don't think we revised that in the current one that's been submitted to you. And I tell you, in the niche review, they've had they've reviewed the constructability of that crossing, and they're satisfied with our responses with regards to how we were going to proceed with the construction. In right. addition
can,
to that,
on that, I don't know what you, I heard what you just said. Yeah. I'm not sure of the impact on some of our questions, but we became aware that the ZBA had requested a hydrology study. We saw the scope of work for the basically to see whether there was ponding.
Yes.
I'm going to call it an abutment. You would call it something other.
It's in your package.
Right. Correct.
Yeah.
But and you're going to talk about our concerns included an alternatives analysis. And I talked to John Leonard and said, you know, what are you folks doing? And he said, well, we've got this hydrology study that's coming, and it has to do with whether or not there's ponding or not. And I was not speaking for the commission. I was speaking for myself. I said, I think that I would like to know from the hydrological perspective whether or not the piered, you know, the plank bridge with the piers would have a different outcome in terms of water flow. And I recognize that that would change the scope of niche engineering, because I think niche was going to do it. And we have no issue in terms of using niche, I don't think, although it is an issue that we need to address.
Niche Engineering has that package, and they wrote a letter in response to that, to that hydrological study. Now, as far as doing...
Did they do the study?
We did the study.
But I thought niche was doing a study.
No.
I saw an $8,400 price quote on a study, and it was to determine whether or not there would be ponding created by, you know, the single conduit of whatever, 10 feet wide or
12
feet wide, 12 feet wide. But essentially going down 4 feet, however deep you go.
Right.
It's essentially an abutment. And is that going to create an impact on water flow?
Well, I was going to get to that kind of later on in the presentation. I can address it now if you wish.
Well, my only concern is that I wanted to see if we could make the best economic use of whatever hydrological study that the ZBA was going to do, to see if we could take advantage of it without additional cost to Mr. Holland, to see if we could kind of piggyback on it, with the caveat that we'd probably need additional information, because I'd like to see if the water can flow under it. And I know there may be a cost impact to that, but you know, we'd need to know that as well. But from an alternatives analysis perspective?
I'll be honest with you. I ran a couple of scenarios, with two 12-foot-wide culverts, as we discussed. I put three in there. I opened it up where it was completely open, where you'd span the whole thing. And obviously, there'd be no difference. But even if you had, I think the most I did were six culverts, and it still had a backup of flow through the water, albeit, minimal. It's just, that's just the way the hydraulics work. You have a cross-sectional area that allows a certain amount of flow to, for that matter, a volume of water to flow through. If it's 200 feet wide and with no obstructions, it's going to come in at, say, elevation 108.3, which it does, according to my hydraulic analysis. If you put in a 12-foot wide culvert, a single one, it's going to come in at 108.77.
But those are just figures to us. Big picture, is it flooding the houses on Randolph Avenue?
No, that's what I'm saying. That's a 100-year storm. So the 100-year storm event floods to elevation 108.77. The wetlands elevation, you could say, floods, is at elevation 110. 108 is completely, 109 for that matter, is completely contained in the property, and there's no flooding off-site or into abutting properties whatsoever with the single culvert.
Right.
So
5.5 inches on a 100-year storm.
Say it again?
5.5 inches on a 100-year storm. And it's fully contained.
And it doesn't breach the bank.
It's fully contained on our property.
All right. Now, and this is not to suggest that you're not 100% accurate, but what I had anticipated was that we would have a consultant. Now, I know in the ZBA, they do a peer review under the 40B statute. We use, and I always get the statute wrong, and Marilyn, you can help me out on this. I think it's Chapter 53, Section 44B, or maybe it's Chapter 44, Section 53B. It's 44 and 53 are in there somewhere, and I probably have them reversed. But we do that on a regular basis. We ask the applicant to pay for our consultant, so they report to us. And it takes it out of the sort of adversarial realm.
So
and we do that pretty regularly.
Yeah, so we've understood, and obviously we've said before that the applicant is prepared to pay for necessary peer reviews. In this case, the niche civil engineering peer review included this issue and included a review of the culvert size and calculations that Jim is speaking about. And I think we want to present them and make sure that we answer any questions, but I don't think there's a need for a new peer review on this issue because it was included in the niche peer review. And the niche
the scope review, that I read did not include what I call an alternative
niche's,
analysis.
Niche's review of the culvert sizing calculations was included in the peer review that was done, which included, of course, the full peer review of all the stormwater calculations and many of the stormwater design issues that the Conservation Commission had already expressed some interest and concern in, and you had asked us to have a peer review, and we had said if the ZBA and the Conservation Commission can share the civil engineering peer review of the stormwater, that's good with us, and that's the way it went forward, and that peer review has been reviewing those issues.
I can't tell you how many times I've discussed this, and the scope that I read did not include the pier with a plank bridge.
May I say something?
Yeah.
So what you're talking about is they did the calculations of the stormwater flow, and we agree that we'd like to use NICH to do that, to use that information as well as to do what John is asking for, which is an alternatives analysis to make sure that other options of how that bridge structure, the
pier,
the blockage, other options on how that are affected. So we're talking about using NICH to do that work, to do what they've already done, but to slightly expand the scope to also include an alternatives analysis, which was not included in the NICH review. And that's what we're talking about.
So, okay. So you're correct that NICH didn't do an alternatives analysis because NICH's job was to review the submissions of the applicant, which included the culvert sizing study that Jim would like to present to you tonight, because that's a more recent submission and it is responsive to your concerns. But there's nothing in the wetlands regulations that requires an alternatives analysis for this project. It's required under the wetlands regulations to meet the state stormwater standards and flood prevention standards. And that's what these calculations are demonstrating. And NICH's role has been to check the calculations and make sure that they're accurate. But there's no requirement in the regulations for an alternatives analysis. If the performance standards in the regulations are satisfied.
Actually, we've had some discussions this evening, and I asked the question on purpose because we were at the Glover School, and Jim, you might not have been here.
No.
But I specifically asked the engineer, how wide are your sidewalks? And this is part of the Safer Schools program. And he said, we rely upon ADA and Department of Transportation from Massachusetts, and we require 5-foot sidewalks. If you move your sidewalk to 5 feet, you're going to go over the 5,000, and then you have to do an alternatives analysis. So it is within our province to ask for that. And I think an alternatives analysis is it's sitting there right in front of us.
Let me just say this, John. The alternatives analysis, so here we are, this is the original proposal. And, the culvert was chosen for a reason, to minimize any sort of hydraulic backup, but mostly to allow for the passing of wildlife to go through. And that kind of plays into with regards to that's something we didn't necessarily have to do because it's not a stream, but that falls into the whole guidelines with regards to stream crossings. And I've been in front of you guys long enough to understand that that's something that you guys would want. So when we did the analysis of this single 12-foot wide culvert, we are showing that the backup, any sort of hydraulic backup off a 100-year storm is 5.5 inches and contained within the property. So any other alternatives of that will certainly lessen that. I mean, I doubt we'd go smaller than that if we put a 36-inch culvert, which honestly, if you design the riprap and the release, the scour control correctly on the down gradient side, would more than handle it. So as far as the analysis goes, yes, can we drop the 5.5 inches? It comes to, say 2? Yeah, sure, probably. The thing is it necessary? It's not, because the impacts with regards to this 5.5 inches is negligible and contained within my client's property and isn't necessary.
That's your position. I understand it. But there are other things in the NICH report that indicated that they didn't believe you could get your retaining wall in. You've got like a 2-foot clearance to put a retaining wall in that's 10 feet high, and they don't believe that you can get
NICH engineering said we could do it. Mitch Engineering says they think it will be difficult. They would suggest an environmental monitor, which we agreed to. And, it can be constructed with the methodologies that I selected.
Well, I think we're entitled to ask for, to have a consultant, because I think you're going to get into the excess of 5,000 square feet. I don't know how you can get equipment into a 24-inch wide space to build a 10-foot wall. And it's, part of it is that tight. I don't see how you can get your equipment in there.
So Mr. Burke actually prepared some things to present tonight, and I wonder if we might, this is a little bit hypothetical, this discussion, I wonder if we might let him finish the material that he wanted to present to you.
Okay. Well, like I say, this has been a work in progress with regards to working with the commission and is working with the ZBA and working with abutters and everybody else involved with regards to tweaking this project to get it to a point where it's better than it was originally proposed. And we are at that point. I mean, we worked with regards to the proximity of wetlands. We've moved, redesigned the parking lot to get that retaining wall outside that 25-foot buffer, and we eliminated two spaces on the end over in here. We recreated them internally, didn't create any additional impervious area, in fact, lessened it, and got all the structures, permanent structures, outside that 25-foot no-disturb zone. And then we also talked about what else we did. The vernal pool issue, which I assume is, we addressed that. We hired a consultant for that, and we addressed that issue as well. So there aren't any vernal pools on the site. As far as snow storage and management, we strived ourselves to get those areas at least 50 feet away from the wetlands. Increased them to the maximum amount, and obviously, in bad storm years, obviously they're going to have to manage that, and we discussed that for a significant amount of time as well. I think the significant change of the submission that you have in front of you is the conservative nature of that stormwater. Niche engineering required us to use B soils instead of C soils for comparison. So when you prepare the existing conditions of this project with using B soils, it went from, 7 CFS for a 2-year storm off the site to 1. So we have 1 CFS that I have to hold as a design constraint for a 2-year storm coming off that site. Fairly difficult. And we accomplished that by increasing the size of those detention basins, adjusting the orifices in locations that would supply that design constraint. And then once that was established, all the other storms kind of fell together. We also, the level spread is 3 right. times as long.
Yeah.
Right. So we increased the size of the level spreader as well as we
great.
So I think, and then it's from, we discussed the culvert sizing as well. They asked us to do an analysis. That also came from the abutters engineer from, I know her name, Janet Bernardo is the engineer. I forget who she works for. She is. She requested the same thing, and and after you guys requested, so we pulled that together and developed a model that shows a slight reduction, as we discussed earlier, slight reduction in heights for all storm events, 5 and a half inches being the maximum for a 100-year storm. And that is less, the elevation of that floods to less than elevation 109. 109 is contained within the site. So there's no flooding off site. Everything stays within the wetland. And I'd say that concludes my testimony, or presentation to my testimony. On to the ZBA, huh?
I'm still stuck on this.
I know.
Alternative analysis. And the reason is because I think that, I don't know how you can construct it without increasing the size of the bridge.
Feet.
The 5,000 square feet. I don't know how you can do it.
In, if I can just, because I'm doing a job very similar to this in Hingham and Norwell. It's actually built. They're doing the houses now. The roadway cut through some wetlands, and they were very specific with regards to where the limit of work was. And we'll end up doing the same methodology that we did there, which is you're out in the field, you're staking these erosion control barriers in the field before they're installed. They're inspected by the environmental monitor, an agent, they have an agent in Norwell that inspected it as well. Actually, Scott's boss is the inspector for the town of Norwell for this particular job. So once that's approved, it's installed, and you work within the design constraints of that. And, you know, the environmental monitors there is necessary, obviously a lot in the beginning, with regards to as the tree removal and grubbing of the earth, and then the backfill as you're crossing the wetlands. But once that the erosion control is set for that crossing, that's the limit of work that you can't cross anymore. So you're going to have, at that point, set up dewatering, as shown in the plan, and you're going to come in there with an excavator and with a truck right behind it. He's going to start excavating, removing the fill that's going to be stockpiled once you get into the wetlands, and they'll end up stockpiling that at a protected location outside the 100-foot buffer, and he's going to replace that with common fill or perhaps structural fill, and then he's going to creep out and repeat the process. And then as you get to that point where you're going to be coming up, you start placing the wall, and the wall is it's such a product.
Sorry, one second.
Good. The wall is such a product that it takes the backfill. It provides the lateral support for any excavation, and then that prevents the sloughing off of the fill coming into the excavation hole. So
can you explain? I'm sorry. So what I was going to ask you was, does the excavation require sheet piling? Because you're proposing to excavate 4 feet below the existing soil.
Three feet
below the existing soil. So in a width, within a footprint, within a width of 2 feet of the final width.
Mm-hmm.
So you're talking about a 60% pitch on your excavation of wet material. So how are you doing containment without using sheet piles?
Well, if we have to use sheet piles, we'll have to use sheet piles.
Okay,
but I don't.
So you're saying that that might be part of the strategy.
We're not moving the line. So
no.
Yeah,
I'm just trying to.
Yeah.
I don't think it's reasonable to think that you're going to do an excavation like that without using sheet piles.
It's going to be. The thing is, we've done three test borings in the area. I don't have the figures in front of me. The deepest was like 3 feet. Just 34 inches, I want to say, of the loam and sub and muck before you get to the hard pan. And there was another location where I think it was less than 2 feet. So maybe we'll run into a situation where, we're going to have to, put some sheet piling or some sort of the methodology to keep it from sloughing into the hole to be able to place that stone. But we're going to be moving so slowly across that that I don't see that being an issue. It might be a concentrated little spot where you have to throw in, you know, an 8-foot sheet. It doesn't have to go down that deep either.
Right.
You know, so it's the construction itself, it'll be slow in the beginning, but once you get that first course down.
Once you've got your sub, you're off and running, and you're basically as fast as you can go.
Right.
But it's really, how do you get it in without.
I mean, if we have to use sheets, we'll have to use sheets. I think it's going to be somewhat of a field decision once we get out there and we see.
Based on how much.
Yeah, it'd be almost like you'd have them on.
The environmental monitor will be able to.
But that's my fear, that field changes, and we're accustomed to the construction world. That's all I see is field changes and people fighting over change orders and proposed change orders because of field changes. It never goes according to the original plan. I don't think I've ever seen a project.
I don't think we wouldn't be changing the limits of our excavation. We might change our methodology slightly if we were going to drive piles versus.
I mean, if you want to do soldier piles. I mean, if you want to do small little, you know, like a, honestly, you could almost do like a picket fence if you wanted to, you know, and actually, that's not a bad idea.
Well, does that idea, let's say you're going to put piles in and you're going to do a picket fence,
mm-hmm.
does that alter your calculations? Do your calculations assume that you have flow underneath the dike? What were you calling it?
All the piers?
No, the, what's the what?
The concrete planks?
Culvert, whatever. Yeah. No, not the culvert, but the wall that we're building.
Oh, an abutment. I referred to it as an abutment.
Yeah, okay. So in your calculations, are you assuming that there's flow under the abutment? And or is 100% of the flow occurring through the culvert?
100% of flow is going through the culvert.
Okay, so however this compresses the ground, however we flow, reduce the flow of water going underneath the abutment, 100% of the water is going through the culvert. So any of that underflow is irrelevant.
Correct.
Okay.
So, but like I say, you know that picket fence is temporary.
Yeah, you'd be pulling it out.
Yeah. So, and that, like I said, but I kind of like the idea.
All right. Other questions?
Yes. I have questions from the NISH report.
Sure.
Just in terms of the back and forth, they make reference to a.
What do you want?
I'm on
June. Which?
June. Both June 29th. 19th
or 4th.
19th. Oh, 4th. I'm sorry. This is June 4th. They're both dated June 4th, actually. The smaller of the two. I'm looking at item page 6 of 11, item number 8. They make reference to a Massachusetts National Heritage Endangered Species is estimated priority habitat located on the down gradient side of the culvert.
Mm-hmm.
And you indicate that there is no such estimated habitat. I'm just, where did they get the, and they refer to a map, a constraints map, figure one, which I wasn't able, I didn't.
Okay. Are you speaking about the abutters consultant, Horsley Whitten's letter, or the NICH town peer review?
I'm sorry, this is Horsley Whitley.
So this is a letter that was done for the abutters.
Yeah.
By an outside engineer.
Yeah.
No.
It's not NICH.
No. This is the Selberg.
No, there's a response letter from me for both.
I'm sorry, that's correct. My mistake. It's not NICH. It's
so
Horsley Whitten.
Number 8, you said?
Yes. Yes. It's, I was looking at number 8, page 6. This is the abutters.
Horsley Whitten, number 8.
Yes. And it was my mistake. It was not NICH. This is Horsley Whitten.
There's rare endangered species located across the street down gradient.
Okay, so they were their references to something that's so far off site that it's not pertinent.
Right.
Okay.
If it were on the site, we'd have to file with Natural Heritage, but it's not on the site, so there's no filing requirement.
Right. Okay. But you're quoting from the.
I'm quoting from
portion of it. Oh, okay.
I'm quoting from the first portion of it,
okay.
The original question.
Okay.
And they've included their responses. Okay. So the comment there is it's it's so far down gradient that it's not relevant to the
correct
topic at hand. Okay.
Correct.
The second item that I had. In the next item, there's discussion of the down gradient culvert to receive the flow from this, that there's actually a reduction in the flow volume, but an increase in the flow
other way.
What? No, I thought it was the, there's a reduction in the volume, but there's an increase in the total. Meaning that it's expanded over an extended period of time.
Right, so there's not a reduction in volume. And there is a reduction in peak flow.
Oh, that's okay, right. There's a reduction in peak flow, but the volume, the overall volume went up because you have,
right.
You're doing detention.
Right, and that's exactly what detention is.
Okay, but my question is how is that relevant to the culvert downstream and its capacity?
It's not.
And as long, what you're saying is as long as that capacity can handle the peak, the overall volume is irrelevant.
Correct. That is point on.
Because it's not going to cause a, it's not going to, you're not going to swamp the system.
We're not surcharging that pond, that culvert.
Even though, because you've reduced the peak flow. Correct. You're not going to surcharge the system.
Correct.
Sorry. I hate glasses.
Call them cheaters.
Yeah. On item number 10. And this is an item that I hadn't considered before. When we were talking about the detention basins, what are they called? What are the detention products underneath the parking lot?
Oh, hand core pipes.
Hand core?
Yep.
Okay, the hand core. We were talking, an issue that they brought up here is that they shouldn't be installed within 20 feet of a foundation, fear of undermining the foundations and lack of, and bad access.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw your response. My question is relative to the retaining wall, and does the introduction of that the volume of water that we're introducing into the ground on the upgradient side of the retaining wall reduce the loading capacity of the retaining wall over time? Because, I mean, you think about California, mudslides, it's because we're surcharged, in those situations, they're surcharged the uphill side,
sure.
And therefore they've released it and they've caused a situation where there's sloughing. Does the introduction of the water on the uphill side of the large, I'm thinking of this large 12-foot retaining wall on the downhill mm-hmm. side, does basically loading that with water potentially cause a reduction in the capacity of the retaining wall?
I would have to say no. I mean,
that's not my gut.
I know. What's that? That's not
that's not my gut.
That's my gut.
Yeah.
But the reason being is that you're going to have the geotextile fabric shooting out from
right.
all those layers.
Yeah.
That's going to grab onto the soils. And the only time, when you have, you know, soil failure is kind of flowing with the water. The perk rate for these soils are better than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
But still, you know, you're looking at rates, I think, 0.52 inches per hour.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that particular flow, for that to carry soil,
I don't know that it needs to carry. My problem is that I don't know that it needs to carry. If you've increased the saturation level of the soil,
so it becomes
that's
plastic.
You plasticize it. If you plasticize it, at what point what does it take to plasticize the soil on the uphill side of the retaining wall? And does putting these retention devices, does that actually push you closer to that limit, to the point where it's a concern?
Well,
I don't know the answer to that,
and I don't either. I guess my answer would be is that we've hired Gary Teal. Well, we haven't actually had. We got a proposal from Gary Teal to do the retaining wall design
yep.
for the site, and Mr. Teal is the owner and proprietor of Stone Stong Products
of that system.
Yeah, of that system.
Okay.
And he has the site plans and...
Can you give us a letter that says that it's resolvable? He doesn't need to figure it out. He just needs to tell us that it's resolvable.
Sure.
Right? Just tell us that this is an issue that can be resolved within the system, in the design. If it means they have to go deeper with the fabrics
whatever they...
Yeah, or for that matter, use different material.
Maybe use a different material, or stake it, or something else.
Right, yeah, tiebacks.
Right.
Yeah.
Just to say that it's resolvable.
Sure.
That's, I don't need to know now how they're going to resolve it, just...
Right.
Okay. Okay, let me see, got a couple more here. The gradient plan, they talk up in this, in their evaluation, they talk about the redirecting of the upland, of the off-site water flowing across the site, and the response was that the grading plan redirects that around the new construction.
Correct.
The calculations that you've done concerning the flow into the wetland take into account all of that flow as part of the peak, and therefore that discussion is irrelevant with the exception of erosion. As long as you're controlling erosion, that volume of water is, that you haven't changed the tributary area.
No.
You're just rediverting the water, and as long as you're dealing with erosion, it's not an issue.
Correct.
Okay. That's what I have.
No, I'm just wondering, and Evan, wondering how much we're dependent upon the final report from CBA.
Absolutely, because if they come back and say you've got to have a 5-foot sidewalk, or if they come back and say you've got to have a 30-foot roadway, it's going to change everything.
Right. Yeah. So my question is, what is the timing on that?
40 days.
So I think you're making a very good process point, and we were actually going to come to that. We wanted to discuss that with you. There is a 40-day period now for the ZBA to deliberate, and then they have a 14-day period to actually write their permit with conditions. And we would like to suggest, therefore, that this hearing at the end of tonight be continued to the September meeting, because we think that will give enough time for the ZBA to completely conclude its process, and it will make more efficient use of your time, that we can come back at that point and really know what all the details are.
That's right, John.
Yeah. Makes sense. But before we get to that point, I'd like to ask for, and Judith, do you have any questions?
Well, just I think the point that natural heritage is in the process of reevaluating, you know, their areas as we speak. So they're definitely on the other side of Randolph Ave and slightly south. And within the next month or two or six, it could be seen that, in fact, and for us this is essential, because if it is an area of a special concern or rare species, then that's exactly what we're here to protect. I'd be very interested in seeing when their further review is coming in those new maps.
So those new maps have been promised since 2009, and we know that they've done them, and they are just sort of holding them for release. There's no definite release. I mean, as far as I know, Scott, there's no definite release date. But everything that we've heard, and when we've heard about particular locations on the maps, everything we've heard is that they've pulled the areas back, their priority and estimated habitat areas, and generally made them smaller and more defined, not bigger. I don't think we have any reason to think that that's going to be different here.
I wouldn't anticipate it being enlarged.
And
I wouldn't be surprised if Natural Heritage doesn't issue those maps for several months, even potentially into next year. I think the governor has asked for like a review of a lot of the regulations, and that process goes into, I think, 2016 before getting signed off. So it's conceivable that the next map comes out long after, could be next year. So it could be potentially after, you know, this meeting would be closed. But I wouldn't anticipate, I'd be shocked if we came back and Natural Heritage had mapped something significantly different than what's currently mapped across the street and further down gradient.
All right. Any questions from abutters, members of the public? Anybody?
One up, Joe.
Can I use that one? Joe Mullins, 300 Highland Street. I don't know what I can add to the discussion here tonight, but I'll try. Couple of points I was thinking about. Did I just hear a request for an extension of this hearing till September?
Yes.
I'm guilty of not being informed about a lot of these things, how they work, but it would seem to me that the ZBA and the Conservation Commission, should they be working in concert and having them conclude or in around the same time?
Yeah, that would be working in concert. That's actually the reason for requesting that continuance. There are only two Conservation Commission hearings between now and then. One of them is in July, and that will be before the ZBA has even made its decision about the project. And then the next one is in August, and it's something like August 11th, around there. And that's also a little bit before the ZBA is likely to have issued its permit. Our thought is that we'll be in a position to incorporate any final conditions and any particular details into the plans and come back with a, you know, totally consistent package for the Conservation Commission at that time.
I guess what occurred to me is, doesn't it make sense for the ZBA to understand the terms and conditions that you've established with regards to the wetland? That's a question, really. I don't know.
Well,
I can't even answer that.
It's a little bit like the chicken and the egg, because one of the difficulties I'm having personally is that the width of the road and the width of the sidewalk is going to drive some of the alterations in the wetlands. Because if the road gets wider, then there's more wetlands that need to be altered. And if that's true, it changes the whole analysis of the project. And it may actually involve a MEPA review.
Right.
But we don't know.
Right.
We don't know that.
I was at the last CBA hearing, and the decision was to close the public hearing Wednesday or Friday, whichever it was. There was some additional information I think Ms. Levin was
Friday
going to submit.
Right. Friday
at 1:30,
yeah.
Something like that. And then I asked Mr. Mullen when the 40 days expired. He said July 29th. So I presume that 40-day period is a deliberation period, and it's within that period of time they have to make their decision?
Correct.
Okay.
And then there's a 14-day period for them to write the permit.
Oh, okay. I didn't hear that. But so I guess I'm back to the issue of everything I've heard at the ZBA in the public hearing from different people, including Kathleen O'Donnell and some of the board members, is that if I were a betting man, I'd say you're going to wind up with a comprehensive permit with the condition that the road be doubly wide, at least from what I've heard. Now, I can't prove that, but that's what I understand is going to happen. So if that's the case, I guess if I'm tripping, what you're saying is you don't want to have this conclude until after you find out what they've decided the road should be.
I mean, I think that's what the commission is suggesting as well.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes, correct.
Okay.
It makes a big difference to us.
Yeah.
Oh, I think you're going to hear on July 29th, at least from what I've heard, of that 14-day period afterwards. The only other point I would make is that with regards to the hydrological study, which I spoke with Scott Turner, the niche person doing the report.
Yes.
And he said he was asked by Mr. Leonard to prepare a scope and a price for the work to be done. And you mentioned $8,500. I didn't hear a price, but I presume that
I saw that scope and it was $8,400.
I don't think that report's been completed yet, has it?
I don't believe so, because I just saw it last week.
So
it was still in the proposal stage, so I don't know.
I would think that's kind of an input.
I haven't seen it. I know.
Well, I asked Mr. Turner, I said, who's going to get that report? Because, again, I'm not an expert in this, but I said, are you going to send it to the ZBA and the Conservation Commission? He said, yes, both will get it. So that's all I can add to it. I know that there is a report approved and going to be prepared for hydrological study.
Okay.
Correct. That's my understanding as well.
That's all I've got.
Okay.
So the question I would ask is that it's in your judgment then that you would want to conclude your conservation hearings until such time as you knew what the ZBA decision was.
Correct.
Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay.
I guess the only other issue that struck me is we just heard from the state requirements for sidewalks with Glover School that you want 5 foot wide so two wheelchairs can go side by side, so possibly there'll be handicapped people, you know, living here, so you'd need 5 foot wide sidewalks.
That's why I asked the question.
Our sidewalks meet ADA.
Well, the state just told us tonight that they have to be
5 feet.
5 feet, didn't they?
We talked about meeting existing, because it's 4 feet.
I believe the guideline is that they have to have a 5 foot passing area with within every 150 or 200 feet.
That was the second question. The first one was, how wide do they have to be? And he said 5 feet. And he said it was ADA, but and I understood what you just said. Mm-hmm. But he said it was ADA, and it's also Mass Department of Transportation.
Right.
That's because I knew this was coming up, so I just wanted to get the DOT's position. All right, so with the applicants, unless there's any further comment or question, the applicant's consent will continue this until September?
That'd be great.
Right?
Thank you.
All right,
thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right, which takes us to Lot 3 Gun Hill Street.
Yes.
Yeah, this
looks pretty much. Yeah.
We need to go out and see this, right?
Yeah. It's Gun Hill.
Is this closest to the street?
We've already done one.
This is the second one.
Lot 3. Lot 3 is done.
Haven't we done two?
Did we do two?
I thought we did.
Well, what lot is it? Is it Lot 2 or Lot 3?
Three.
It's Lot 3. This is the second one.
Right, second one back.
Right.
Okay.
When do you like to do it? Don't say Saturday.
Saturday.
Not in the snow.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's right.
So if we get there, if we're at Deposit Valley Parkway at 8 o'clock, we'll be out of there in less than half an hour, maybe half an hour. So yeah. Do we drive to Gun Hill?
8:30, 8:45.
8:30 Gun Hill?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. That won't be long. And you've got the filings? You've got the as-built? You're looking for a certificate of compliance.
Correct.
Right.
Actually, you didn't give me an as-built.
I give you as-built.
Oh. Should be
enough. What I screwed up was the key.
Oh.
Yeah, Gun Hill. There's a drawing in our set. Thank you.
Is that it?
That's it.
That's it.
See you at 8:30, 8:45.
Sounds great.
See you then. Thank you.
All right, which leads us to number 7, additional business. I don't see anybody in the audience. Anything? This could be a record.
Is it number 7-7 or is it number 8?
Hey, actually, you're right. Holy cow.
This is pretty good. Right?
This is pretty good. How do we do this?
I don't know. Somebody has some place to go.
We should just hang out here and play cards with them.
I'm still last.
We're last always.
Do we have anything else, Kathy?
Good night. Have a nice week.
Aye.
Motion to adjourn.
That was good business.
Yeah. Motion to adjourn has been heard. Seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
We're in adjournment. Thank you.